Good morning, my name is Charlotte Glenn. I'm the horticulture agent for North Carolina Cooperative Extension based at the Chatham County Center. I will be talking about native plants today and their importance in the landscape and how we can bring back more Piedmont native plants to our local landscapes. All right, well thank you, Mark. So as Mark said, the handout's going around. My name is Charlotte Glenn, and as Mark said, I'm the horticulture agent down in Chatham County, so based in Pittsburgh. And I do know a lot of native plants because that's really how I got started in horticulture and in gardening. Since I was about 10 or 12 years old, I was really interested in the things that were growing on the roadside. And I had a grandmother who was really interested in native plants and nature as well as gardening. So that introduced me to the whole realm of growing plants and nature. And now, finally, native plants have become more popular as landscape plants. People are increasing interest in bringing more native plants to their landscape. So that's what we're going to talk about today. We'll start off kind of talking about the importance of native plants and actually what is native, because it's really important if you want to add natives to your landscape to have an idea. You know, not everything you find in a garden center that maybe says native is native here. You know, some of it might be native to Colorado or Washington State, and that's not the same as Central North Carolina. So I do want to let you know that the slides you're seeing today are posted online, and this link is the first thing that's on your handout. So when you look at the top of that left column, it has the link there. So you can go to the site. You will actually find some more extensive versions of the talk today. I gave a two-series talk down in Chatham County where one focused on perennials and one trees and shrubs. So what you'll find actually has even more plants listed than what we'll see today. And so there are other resources and links listed on that site. Most things I'll mention here in the talk today, if I mention a website, it'll be listed here at this address. So you could go and review and learn more. So we're talking about return of the native, so bringing native plants back. Of course, at one time, everything was native plants. Then people came in and we needed to use the land for agriculture. We needed to use the land for building houses. So we spent all this time clearing out native plants, right? I'm from Eastern North Carolina, which was a swamp originally. And so we spent all that time down there clearing the swamp, ditching and draining everything. And now we realize that maybe wasn't such a good idea. We might have done too good of a thing. And we are bringing back the swamps. People are putting in constructed wetlands. People are restoring stream banks. People are bringing native plants back. So we're going to talk about what are natives and why you should plant them, and then we'll cover some native plants that are good for Piedmont landscapes. And I've listed a few of resources at the end. So there's a lot of definitions out there for native plants. The simpler ones would be like anything that grew in this area before Europeans came. Because when people came, started coming from other parts of the world, they started bringing different plants with them. Some of those plants were really happy, things like daylilies. They're from Asia, but now we find them here. Some people call them ditch lilies, and you see just especially the orange ones. And they tend to persist, you know, after they're cultivated. So not everything that's growing in a natural area on the roadside was originally native here. And the definition I really like for native plants comes from a book by Doug Tallamy, who's up at the University of Delaware. He's an entomologist. His other book is called Bringing Nature Home, and it's had a big impact for a lot of people, both professionals and home gardeners, in realizing the link between native plants and our natural ecosystems. But his second book was co-written with Rick Dark, who is a great plantsman. And it's called The Living Landscape, and it focused more on how to use native plants in your landscape. And they have come up with this definition that I think is really extensive and inclusive and does a good job of giving you a full definition of what's native. So they say if it's native, it's a plant or animal, excuse me, that has evolved in a given place over a period of time, sufficient to develop complex and essential relationships with the physical environment and other organisms in a given ecological community. So that's a lot of stuff. We'll look at the different parts. One of the most important components of defining native is the place. So everything's native to planet Earth so far. I don't know if anything that we brought back from the moon or other places that is living and growing, But so everything's native to planet Earth. So to make it relevant to where you are, you have to narrow down that definition. You have to give an area. And so a lot of times people will say, well, I just want to grow things that are native to my county or to my state. But that's not really how plants and animals behave or think. So plants especially respond to climate, and they respond to soil types and elevation. They have no idea what county or state they're growing in. Those are our definitions. So really, when talking about something being native, it's better to think about ecoregions, ecological regions. And these are divided based on climate, soil types, kind of natural history of the area. And there is the ecoregions of North America. They actually are several levels. You can see the first level is very broad. So the whole eastern part of the United States, the eastern deciduous forest. And then it breaks them down finer and finer. But level 3 defines the Piedmont, starting, you know, up here in Northern Virginia, coming down through North Carolina. This is about where we are right now. You know, going down through Georgia and just reaching over into Alabama. So this is the area when I'm selecting native plants. This is the area I'm thinking of for the Piedmont area. And that doesn't mean, of course, that plants that grow in some of these adjacent regions won't also do well here. But the plants that are in our local ecoregion are most likely to support our native pollinators, our native insects, our native birds, and other creatures. So that's where you want to focus when you're choosing natives. And of course, you'll also find that a plant may grow here, but it may also grow here and here, you know, and here and here and here. So some native plants have a really broad range. And those tend to be things that are very adaptable and can grow in a lot of different climates and conditions. So the next is period of time. And this really gets to, is something actually native, or was it introduced and has it naturalized? So our orange daylily. So a lot of things that come here, especially from parts of Asia that have similar climates, they adapt really well to our climate, and they persist after we plant them. Sometimes they spread on their own, and that's more of a concern. But anything that's been here long enough to develop relationships with insects, with other things that were also native here, has typically been here thousands of years. So far and long before humans started bringing plants from other areas. So we really are looking things that developed, that evolved here with other insects and organisms that are also native to our area. So non-native things you'll find out in natural areas include what are called naturalized plants. So these are just things that tend to persist after we plant them. They might spread a little bit just in one colony, like the daylilies. You know how daylilies will spread, but they don't really go off site. You know, they don't spread. You won't see them or find them popping up miles away. Those things that persist and spread are called invasive plants. So things like Japanese honeysuckle, which is blooming right now, it smells wonderful, but it is one of our, you know, most invasive plants in most areas of North Carolina and the eastern United States. You know, that and things like Eleagnus and Chinese privet. Not only do they spread, wherever you plant them, they spread and grow over that stuff, but then they produce berries or they produce some type of fruit that birds like, and so birds spread them around. So before long, just about any woods you walk into or edge of the woods, you're going to find Japanese honeysuckle. So it's very pervasive. It grows and covers other things, so it can choke out native plants, and it can prevent other native plants from coming back in and growing in that area because it covers the ground. It's basically somewhat evergreen, so it prevents anything that might germinate and try to come up in early spring from coming up. So those are the real plants of concern that you want to identify if you have on your property and try to get rid of. So complex and essential relationships, this is what needs that very long period of time. Insects, plants themselves actually produce a lot of natural chemicals, a lot of defenses against things eating them, especially things like caterpillars or beetles eating them. There's a lot of natural chemicals implant leaves, and in fact, that's where a lot of our pesticides are based. You know, we know that naturally some plants produce things like pyrethrins, a type of chrysanthemum, and we've been able to make a synthetic version of it for a whole group of pesticides called the synthetic pyrethroids. But they were based on that natural chemical that plants produce. So over time, you get some caterpillars and beetles particularly specializing on feeding on certain plants. They can naturally detoxify those chemicals the plant produces. So that's a very unique relationship. And what you find is those caterpillars can only feed on certain plants. They can't handle the natural chemicals other plant families create. They specialize and focus on this one group of plants. Also with pollinators, there's very close relationships with many of our native pollinators particularly, and the plants they feed upon. In the time that the plant blooms is time to when that pollinator is active, the shape of the flower, all kinds of very intricate relationships. So in the picture, this is a southeastern blueberry bee, which specializes in pollinating many of our native blueberries. We have over a dozen native species of vaccinium, or blueberry, in North Carolina. So this little native bee nests in the ground, spends most of its life in the ground. It emerges, its whole adult lifespan is time to when blueberries bloom. So it comes out and relies on being able to find the blueberry blossoms and some of the close relatives of blueberries to get the pollen and nectar it needs to lay the eggs and provide the little pollen ball that the egg will need to develop for next year's generation. So if all the blueberries are cleared out of an area, then this little bee, when it comes up, has nothing it can eat. This one flies only a mile or two. A lot of our native bees are smaller than honeybees, or some of them are, and they don't tend to fly as far. So honeybees are very general in their feeding. They'll feed on many different plants, and they can forage, you know, 5 or 6 miles from the hive. But our native bees, they tend to look for food closer to home.
Is that a kind of bee that one could import? Is there some place you could buy?
I don't think so. The only type of bees I know that you could typically purchase would be honeybees, and then there's some types of bumblebees that are used for pollination in greenhouses. So yeah, this one, another big thing with a lot of these native bees is since they do nest in the ground, when areas are cleared off and the soil's disturbed, that destroys their nesting habitat. So if you do happen to have some area in your yard where you have ground nesting bees, if they truly are bees, so you want to make sure they're not yellow jackets, of course, but they are not aggressive. You can go stand out there in the middle of them. There'll be multiple holes where you see where they're nesting, whereas the yellow jackets will just have one opening and, of course, look a little different. But a lot of times you don't want to get too close to find out. But then again, our native bees tend to be active in the spring, so May, April, May, June, that's when you see them coming up out of, and there'll be like a colony of little holes. But everyone's kind of living on their own. It's not a hive like in a honeybee hive, so they don't have that defense mechanism. They're not going to attack to protect the hive. And with yellow jackets, it tends to be later in the summer. And you often don't see the opening where they came from. So other things, as we mentioned, so we've got a lot of our native insects are very specialized feeders, so they need those plants to survive. Other insects are more generalist. So honeybees, although they're not native here, they are generalist, so they can live here because they can feed on many different things. A lot of our pest insects tend to be more some of these generalist feeders, some of the things like scale and aphids. There's many types of aphids that are adapted to a certain range of plants. But one of our few generalist feeders that is a native caterpillar is the fall webworm. So you've probably seen this guy on a pecan tree or persimmon tree, sourwood, sweet gum, red bud. Those are some of their favorites. But they can feed on a lot of different plants. So with generalist feeders, they're not necessarily connected to one single species or family of plant. But the interesting thing about fall webworm is it is a native insect, but it's one of the few native pest insects that's actually been exported from the United States to other parts of the world. Most of the time, we bring them in here, but few of our insects have been taken to other places. But the fall webworm's a pretty serious pest problem in other areas, Europe and some other areas of the world. So you also want to think about physical environment. This is really important to plants. What is the soil like? What is the topography like? Is it a slope? Are you in a low area? How does water move? What is the general climate, temperatures, summer temperatures, winter temperatures? And those factors really do create what are called natural communities or communities of plants. So when you go, you know, you can think about certain areas and pictures come to your mind with certain plants, like at the beach, the dune grasses, you know, the sea oats. You could put a pile of sand out front and plant some sea oats, but they will not survive. They will not do well. They need that very harsh climate. They rely on the sand always blowing, and as the sand blows, they actually continually root into the dunes. And if you try to grow them on a stable mound of sand, they just after a year or two, they kind of peter out. So these plants are in some cases very adapted to these physical conditions. Things like trilliums need to grow in the shade. If you put them in full sun, they're not going to be happy. So you need to know that about some of your plants. It's always, of course, you want to right plant, right place. So knowing a little bit about where these plants grow in the wild, the conditions there will help you find the right spot in your landscape. So why plant natives? There's a whole bunch of reasons. You know, it's a really neat group of plants that are well adapted to our climate if you get them in the right place. So that's always important. But one of the biggest things now, as more and more of our area becomes developed, we want to bring these native plants back to support all the other creatures that rely on them. So birds are a great example. You know, you might think, well, I'll put out bird seed for the birds and they'll be fine. And that's okay for the adult birds, but what about for the little baby birds that feed pretty much exclusively on caterpillars and some other insects? So the mommy and daddy bird in the spring this time of year are searching for caterpillars, every caterpillar they can get their beak on. They're taken back to the nest to feed those baby birds. The baby birds need the protein. Of course, caterpillars are really easy to digest. They're nice and soft. And if they can't find the caterpillars that the babies need to develop, then the nest will die. You know, they won't be able to sustain them. And it's amazing to consider how many caterpillars, something like a chickadee nest, can take 6,000 to 10,000 caterpillars. One nest. And there are studies where people have documented this, where they like put cameras for more, and there's other species. I think bluebirds take around 6,000 to 8,000 caterpillars. So you don't have to worry about caterpillars eating your plants up. For every nest of birds out there, there needs to be, you know, 4,000, 5,000, 6,000, up to 10,000 caterpillars taken back. So if we can keep the bird populations healthy, we have this whole natural control in place that's taking care of the caterpillars. So when we do have healthy ecosystems, when we have this balance of all different types of, you know, including insects that feed everything else, when we have that in place, we have a healthy ecosystem, a functioning ecosystem. And we really need healthy ecosystems. And we don't just need them in preserves or in natural areas or state parks. It needs to be throughout the areas where humans are living and throughout the land where anything wants to live. Because these healthy ecosystems provide really important services that we don't pay for, we don't really think about until they're gone. But things like pollination, so we have to support our pollinators if we want our vegetable crops and our gardens to be pollinated, our fruit trees. But it's not just the edible crops we think about growing, it's the native plants that are all around us. So about 75% to 80% of all plants rely on insects for pollination. And if we don't have those native pollinators in place, over time, those plants will die out because they won't be able to reproduce. Purifying the water and the air, plants, especially trees, are a huge part of the water cycle and of creating clean air, filtering out particles from the air. So trees are very important to maintain in our landscapes and in our cities. Forming soil, again, plants are always returning organic matter to the soil. They are supporting microbes in the soil that help build soil. So we want that process to continually go on because otherwise soil would erode. We'd just be going back to bare rock. Balancing pest species. We certainly don't want to have to do pest control or try to control pests without the help of beneficial insects. And they're actually, even beyond just insects that are controlling each other, there are diseases that affect insects. You know, there's fungal diseases you get on your plants, but there's fungal diseases that infect insects. So there is a whole system in place that can help control some of your pest species and keep everything in balance. And then our climate. Forests particularly have a huge impact on temperatures and on rain patterns. And if you remove huge areas of forest, you can change the climate of a region. One of the big things when you look at studies of climate change in the southeastern part of the United States, we haven't seen as much of an impact as some other parts of the world or even the United States. And that's pretty much attributed to the amount of forest cover we still have in place in the southeast. So we want to keep that in place. So with these healthy ecosystems, plants do a lot of really important things. They protect the soil, their roots keep soil in place. Their foliage intercepts rainfall, so you don't just have all this beating rain going down. You know, leaves fall and create a natural mulch. So there's all kinds of ways that plants are preserving and building soil. They help to cycle nutrients because when they're taken up into the foliage, but the foliage falls back down, the nutrients are returned. They're also cycling water and supporting a lot of beneficial microbes that live in the soil, but they live right in conjunction with the root zone of plants. So if you had soil with no roots in it, you wouldn't have that microbe population. But the most important thing is plants' role in the food web. So when you think about what eats what and how energy moves up through the food web and through the ecosystem, it starts with the sun. The sun's a tremendous ball of energy, just sending that energy to us. You know, we're trying to convert that into energy we can use with solar panels, but plants are by far the best solar panels. So plants are there. They are able to intercept the sunlight and turn it into energy that they use to grow. So you might think about fertilizer as plant food, but fertilizer is really just supplementing plants. They do need some of those minerals. But the real plant food is sunlight. So that's why a lot of things don't grow as well in the shade. They don't have that source of energy. So plants can convert sunlight's energy into a form that other things can eat. When we eat plants, we're actually eating that sunlight energy that's been converted into plant material. But a lot of other things eat plants. So there's all these insects, these herbivorous insects, so they eat plants. They rely very much on these plants, and then there's all the things that eat those insects, like the toads and birds. There's snakes. They actually do a good thing out there. There's different types of birds that directly feed on things like seeds, other things that feed on seeds, and then the creatures that feed, you know, at the higher level. So you have this whole food web, and if you were to take out any layer, everything above it's going to collapse. So if we're taking out all the plants, then everything up here is going to collapse. Even if we're taking out a lot of the herbivorous insects with being too rigorous with our pest control, we're taking out everything above it. So we want to keep this balance in place. And it starts with the plants. You know, it starts with the plants, particularly for a lot of our native insects, things like the Luna moth. Their caterpillars will feed on sweet gum. They'll actually feed on several of our native trees. But if you just come in and plant Bradford pear and crepe myrtle and Leyland cypress, there's nothing for the Luna moth caterpillar to feed on. So you'll have a local extinction. They won't be in your area anymore. We need to keep some of the sweet gums and tulip poplars and other trees that they like. So we need to have some of these native plants in place to support the insects and everything that feeds upon them. And these will be plants from your region. And probably the best known example of this are the monarch butterflies. So monarchs are very specialized. They can only feed on one genus of plants, the genus Asclepias, which are known as milkweeds or butterfly weeds. So the orange butterfly weed, Asclepias tuberosus, pretty common here in the Piedmont on dry, sunny roadsides. I think it's so common because it can tolerate mowing. You know, so DOT mows it. And that's directly attributed to the fact that it can tolerate being eaten by monarch caterpillars. So it's used to that. It's used to every now and again everything being removed, and it just grows back out. And it has a big chunky root system that can store energy. So this is a great plant to add to your landscape, beautiful flowers, and it's also going to draw in the monarch caterpillars, as well as being a wonderful plant. The flowers are wonderful for many butterflies to gather nectar. So we have over 15 species, or around 15 species of Asclepias that are native to North Carolina. The butterfly weed and the common milkweed and swamp milkweed are probably the most common that we think about growing. But we need to keep those plants in place. And as they disappear from natural areas, if we can bring them back into our landscapes, we can continue to support the monarch population in our area. Yes?
Is the butterfly weed the same thing as a butterfly bush?
No. So common names can be really tricky. The question was, is butterfly weed the same thing as butterfly bush? So butterfly bush is a completely different plant, Buddleia from Asia. The flowers do attract a lot of butterflies, but monarch caterpillars can't feed on it. There aren't really any caterpillars that feed on butterfly bush, whereas butterfly weed is Asclepias. So, you know, a lot of times these Latin names, like if you look at this word, you have no idea how do you say that. So you don't need to necessarily know how to say it, but you need to just be able to recognize it. Common name, it's much easier for us to talk to each other with common names, with things like butterfly weed or butterfly bush. But when you're researching plants, and especially when you're buying plants, you do want to make sure that you can at least recognize the scientific name and that information's there. So that's the way to be sure you're getting what you intend to get and plant. Because common names can be really similar. They can be different in different areas. You know, what your grandmother called it is different than what my grandmother called it. So,
because I had read that the butterfly bush was becoming an invasive.
Yeah, the butterfly bush, particularly in the mountains in western Piedmont, can self-seed and become a bit of a nuisance.
I saw it looked like a red
Asclepias.
There
is a tropical milkweed that is much redder in color. It's more from Central and South America. We grow it here as an annual sometimes. That may have been what it was.
Okay.
If it was in a garden center or a garden.
No, it was in the wild at Twin Lakes, but
okay.
After they bulldozed it, that
yeah.
Area.
There's a pink, dark pink one, but there's not a true red one in the wild.
Where can you get the milkweed, the butterfly weed? Can you get it?
Yeah, so many garden centers, the popularity of milkweed and people wanting to add these plants, particularly to support monarchs, the orange butterfly weed, and then there's a pink swamp milkweed. Most places that carry a good range of perennials will carry those plants. So we do see this trend in North Carolina. This is a great place to live, and people want to come here, right? So, and here we are in the heart of this highly developed, you know, this area, the popular growth area. So we're seeing more and more of our natural area converted into, you know, residential properties, into commercial properties. And, you know, this is by far the most efficient way to do that development, just to come in and remove everything and start from scratch. But we're removing a lot of this native plant material. So what we can do when we come back and plant those plants, when we make choices about the plants, is we can say, you know, we don't really want to go with all this turf, or we don't want to just have just these non-native plants like hydrangea and crepe myrtle. We want to bring some of those native plants that were removed, we want to bring them back in. We want to add them back to the landscape. So our landscapes can continue to function ecologically and support these other creatures. So that's a big challenge for us now. It's a big challenge for the horticultural industry, for gardeners, is to kind of switch our thinking. For, you know, forever when you went to choose a plant to plant in your landscape or your yard, you were just looking at, oh my gosh, it's beautiful and I want it. You know, I really like this. Look, it's got more petals, more pink. So we're just basing it a lot on appearance. And then, of course, sometimes you find that doesn't work. You love something at the store, you plant it in the ground, and it dies. So you might do a little more research. Like, not only do I want it to look pretty, I want it to be adapted to my site. I need something that's real drought tolerant. You know, so that layer of knowledge and education. But now we need to add even another layer, and we need to think about, not only is it pretty, do I like it, does it fit my landscape and what I'm trying to achieve there? Is it adapted to my landscape condition so I don't have to water it all the time or it just won't survive? But also, will it help support things like monarchs, pollinators, beneficial insects? Will it help support the ecosystem? So that's how we need to move beyond just that ornamental thought. And, you know, calling landscape plants ornamentals really downplays their role or their potential role in supporting the ecosystem. There are some rare, there are some populations of Echinacea purpurea in North Carolina in the Piedmont on very specific soil types. So it is does naturally occur in North Carolina, but it's not widespread.
It do help.
Yeah, so there are some natural populations, and it does support a lot. Because it's native in a lot of the eastern part of the United States, and a lot of species like some of the butterflies and birds we find here are also native across that wide range. So it does feed and support. Like you say, birds will eat the seed. A lot of pollinators will visit the flowers. So we need to think about these landscape plants beyond just ornamental. We need to think about them as living organisms that are part of the environment, part of the ecosystem, and are they giving back and supporting that ecosystem, not just taking resources. So thinking about beyond just the appearance and adaptation, but what they support, what other creatures, you know, are bees, not only just honeybees, but our native bees, butterflies, other pollinators going to find resources there, our birds going to be able to collect berries in the winter, caterpillars in the spring. And again, you know, a lot of times people will be concerned, they're like, you want me to plant something so caterpillars can eat it? which just goes against all gardening wisdom. And of course, that's not what we're saying. Like for a vegetable garden, we don't want to let, you know, the cabbage whites. Many of our pests in vegetable gardens are actually imported. They came with the vegetable crops. So you don't have to worry so much when in your vegetable garden when you're trying to get rid of those caterpillars on your broccoli or cabbages that you're killing something that was going to be one of our native butterflies or moths. But with our native trees and shrubs, what we find is that they have adapted for many of these caterpillars to feed upon them. Their feeding is just for a short time period for these native species of caterpillars and moths. A lot of them, birds are helping control them, or some of the ones that come out in the fall, such as the Polyphemus moth, which is a relative of Luna moth. They have these gorgeous, huge caterpillars. But you just find them sporadically on a tree. They don't tend to be hundreds all in one place. But they feed in the fall when the tree was going to lose its leaves anyway, so it's not really causing serious damage. So in a natural rhythm, these plants have adapted to this feeding, and it's not going to hurt the plant. And it's not going to be something that spreads to everything in your garden either. Pretty much anything you find on a tree or shrub in your landscape is then not going to eat your vegetables, and vice versa. The caterpillars and beetles that feed on your vegetables aren't going to spread to your lawn or to your landscape plants. So when we talk about bringing natives back, we definitely want to see natives in every landscape, but we're not saying every plant has to be native. You don't have to be really extreme about it. There are some things that can be a little more challenging. We don't have a lot of low-growing evergreens to choose from when we talk about native plants. You know, there's things like wax myrtle, which is huge. You know, we can find mountain laurel and rhododendron here in the Piedmont, but on very specific sites, north-facing slopes. They're huge plants, and they're not going to work in every landscape. So it's certainly fine to have some non-native plants in your landscape. We're not saying it has to all be native. And also with natives, it doesn't necessarily mean that they're going to be well behaved. So some natives are much better to just let grow in natural areas. Some of them spread a lot. So you have to know, you want to know a little bit about the plant itself. Longevity, you know, this is true for all plants, not just natives, but especially when we're talking about perennials. Perennial is a plant that returns more than a couple of years from the roots, the same root system. You don't have to replant them, but some perennials only return, say, 2 or 3 years, and then they're kind of done. They set a lot of seed. You'll get seedlings coming up. So some of our natives are like that, such as Golden Alexanders, which is a relative of parsley. You can tell by the leaf and the flower shape. But it's a self-seeder. You know, some things like Coreopsis, Gaura can even be like that. So they do rely on disturbance, kind of just pop up here and there. So if you're looking for a plant, you want to plant in a spot and you want it to be there 10 years from now, you wouldn't want to plant something like Golden Alexander. You want to plant something longer lived. And you can find out that type of information from, there's some great reference books out there, and I've listed some at the end of the presentation. Some of our native plants spread, just like some of our non-native plants spread, spread by the roots, you know, so that can be something that if you're plant a hardy ageratum in a spot and you just intend for it to fill a little 2-foot spot, well, in about 2 or 3 years, it's going to be filling a 20-foot spot because it's a really vigorous spreader. It has rhizomes that spread under the soil. Some of our goldenrods are vigorous spreaders, so you want to know that type of thing about any plant. I don't know if anybody here, not a native plant, but if you've ever planted mint, peppermint, spearmint, right? You probably wish you had known before you planted it how vigorously it spread. So this is good information to know about any plant before you put it in the ground. Sometimes people will plant some of these, especially these self-seeding natives like Salvia lyrata, the lyre leaf sage, which has been blooming on the roadsides the last month or so. And it's a real prolific seeder. So they'll say, oh, I planted that native plant and it was weedy. You know, so don't judge all natives on just experience with one plant. And again, you can find that type of information out in a lot of the references. Some of the websites that are available will tell you, is this plant a self-seeder? Are you likely going to have it? These plants are really good for areas you just want to naturalize. If you want to have something like a meadow area, these are the type of plants you want. But if you have a more managed landscape, you want to stick with things that stay in one spot and don't spread around or pop up where you're not expecting them. So with that term weedy, that really does mean just, you know, plants that are spreading within cultivated areas. But when we use the term invasive, we really are talking about non-native plants that are capable of harming ecosystems, things like the Japanese honeysuckle we looked at before. But sometimes people in a garden setting will say, oh, that's so invasive. But really, weedy is the better term for something that's spreading around your garden. We have some truly gorgeous native plants that we can't grow in our landscape. So just because it is native and is adapted to growing in the wild doesn't mean it's going to be available from a nursery, because some of these plants are really difficult to propagate. And that's a common question is, you know, well, why can't I buy it anywhere? And sometimes it's really slow or difficult to propagate. Other things like this, the lady lupin, which grows in these deep sandy soils in the southeast, that's the only place they'll grow. They would never. They wouldn't even dream of living a day in clay, you know. So you pretty much have to buy a property where they're growing to have those plants. Things like pitcher plants, the saracenias, these are carnivorous plants. The insects go down into the trumpets and get digested. They grow in swampy soils, mostly in the coastal plain and sand hills. So you can grow these in containers. You can recreate those natural conditions, but they're not just going to grow in your average garden or landscape setting. So that all goes back to understanding the plant, true for natives as well as any plant you put in your landscape. You want to understand a little bit about the plant, what its needs are. Does it need sun or shade? Does it need well-drained soil? Does it like to grow in a wetter, boggier area? Does it have specific conditions for soil, like pH, like blueberries need really acidic soil? How much space does it need? So these are all things you want to find out about a plant before you put it in your landscape, including natives. Another question that's really common when people start talking about natives is if it's a cultivar, so if it's a name variety, does it serve the same function? Is it still native? So if we look at something like purple coneflower, this is the wild form. So you can see it has that big cone in the middle with this one single ring of petals. And we have a lot of cultivars now that have different colors, or they have these really shaggy blossoms. So they still have the big petals, but they have all these little petals up around the middle. So is that going to do the same thing? Are pollinators going to be able to find nectar and pollen in this flower as easily and prolifically as they can in that flower? What do you think?
No.
So in general, with really double blossoms, that does greatly reduce this plant's ability to support pollinators. So that means you should never plant this one. It just means we need to plant some of this one too. You know, plant the natural form and include some cultivars. And in general, when you're looking at a cultivar, or sometimes nativars is the term that's used, you want to look at that plant and think about, well, how different is it from the native form? We have some really neat purple leaf red buds available. There's a gold leaf red bud. So we want to think about, you know, how much do they vary from the natural form? And so if the flowering time's really different, if the flower shape, so really double blossoms, or flower color is really different, even foliage color, because foliage color is affected by pigments that change the flavor and the chemicals that are naturally in the leaf. So that can affect if it's nutritious to caterpillars, or like I said, with the flower shape and flowering time, if it's useful to pollinators. And again, it doesn't mean we should never use cultivars. It just means have a balance. Have some of the natural, the more wild type or typical form. And, you know, if you like one of the cultivars, you can include those too. So just a few more things before we talk about the plants themselves. Sometimes people will think, well, if it's native and it grows at the edge of the woods or on the side of the road, I can just plant it anywhere in my yard and it'll just do okay without any care. But that's not true in most cases, because our yards are really different than the woods, the edge of the woods, or even sometimes the roadside. Our soils have been disturbed, they've been compacted. The way water moves in the soil can be very different. So we do need to prepare the soil before we plant natives, or before you plant anything. That is going to definitely help them establish and persist much better. So preparing the soil by cultivating the soil to alleviate compaction, adding organic matter, so adding compost and mixing that into the soil, is going to help return organic matter to the soil that's been removed a lot of times when we take off the topsoil, or how we are managing the land can reduce the amount of organic matter in soil. We want to water these plants, especially during that first season. As they get established, it takes some time for the root system to get out of that little container pot, of that little ball of potting mix that they were growing in. You put them into the soil. You have to help them establish. That's the trickiest time for plants, is during that establishment. But most native plants, if you've chosen a good plant for your site, once you get it established, you shouldn't need to do a lot of additional watering unless we're in an extreme drought. You could also mulch. Mulch helps conserve moisture, helps keep down some of the weeds that might be sprouting from seed. To get the most benefit from adding native plants, it's not just adding a native plant here or there, it's how you combine them. So, you know, there's not a lot of diversity here. There's just a bunch of turf and there's some evergreen shrubs and a few trees. So in nature, you want to see a lot of diversity, a lot of different species of plants. It's fine to have a lot of one type of plant and a lot of a different type of plant, but just so overall in your landscape, you have a lot of different plants. So this is extremely diverse, you know. You can still have some lawn area. We're not saying no lawn, but you just don't need to have 90% of your yard in lawn. Have some areas and trees, some perennials. Have different heights. That's really important. Different types of animals and insects live at different heights. So some things are just ground dwellers. Some creatures like to be in that mid-story range, say it's up to about 15 feet. Other things are up in the canopy. So to support all this diversity, you have to have this wide diversity of heights. So thinking about layers, having layers in your landscape, not just turf and trees, but you want some of this mid-layer stuff. In fact, most birds will nest between 5 and 15 feet from the ground. That's the preferred nesting range. So, you know, you think back to drawings kids make, especially, and they'll draw the little bird nest right up here at the very top of the tree, and that's where you think about it. But that's not really where, maybe a few things like hawks, but most of them are nesting right in here. So if we don't have that layer in the landscape, we're not going to have a lot of bird nesting in our landscape. All right, so we're finally here at the plants. So I'm going to introduce you. Hopefully some of these plants are already familiar to you. I've tried to select plants definitely that have an ecological function, so they're valuable to pollinators, they're valuable to some beneficial insects, to some caterpillars. as well as things that are attractive and adaptable to your average landscape conditions. So we're not going to talk about those really rare things like the pitcher plant or the lady lupin, which make you salivate when you see them, but you can't go buy them and put them in your landscape. I'm not that cruel. I'm not going to tell you about those. Also, we're not going to look at things that are really aggressive or finicky. So these are things that can be produced in nurseries. You should be able to find them. You may have to go to a native plant nursery. A resource for us that's relatively close by is the North Carolina Botanical Gardens. It is in Chapel Hill. I know with Cooperative Extension, you know, we're NC State, but you can go to Chapel Hill if you need to buy native plants. I do have a link on the resource page that goes with this presentation that has some native plant nurseries in the region that you can visit locally, as well as there's a lot that you can order from. But many of the plants we're going to look at, you could just go to any garden center and they're going to be available. We'll talk a little bit about trees, then some shrubs, then we'll finish up with some perennials. The trees, again, it's all about layers. So you have your tall canopy trees, your big shade trees that are really getting 40 to 80 feet tall or more. So these are the largest trees, the largest kind of plant in the landscape. We, a lot of times, really value these, try to preserve them because we want that shade. That's a really important environmental benefit with trees is shading and cooling. They protect the soil, and they are extremely valuable. Large trees, canopy trees for many different animals, from birds to mammals to caterpillars, whether you're talking about something's eating the leaves, something's eating the nuts or the fruits, something's visiting the little tiny blossoms for nectars or pollen. And we do need large unbroken areas of woodland. So you're always going to get a benefit from adding a tree to your landscape. But if we can do it strategically, let me show you one more. Well, hold on, I'll tell you about this first. If we can do it strategically, we can have even more benefit. Because these trees really are foraging hubs. They are where the birds are really actively seeking those 6,000 caterpillars they need to raise their one little nest of chickadees. So we want to have these native birds, these native trees in our landscapes for the birds. I attended a talk Doug Tallamy gave, and he was telling us about a study one of his graduate students had in an urban area where they tracked bird foraging in a typical, I think this was near somewhere in Delaware, or perhaps New Jersey, but it was a relatively large urban area. And the birds were in an area where pretty much most of the trees were Bradford pears, some crape myrtles. There were very few native trees in this neighborhood. And so that they were able to trace where the birds went. They were looking for caterpillars. They couldn't find enough caterpillars for their baby birds, and the nests didn't survive. The birds died. The baby birds died. The parents survived, but they went back to some of the nests, and they even found seeds in the nests. So where the parent birds had tried to find anything to feed to the babies, but they couldn't digest. They couldn't eat those seeds. So it's very important to have some of these native trees around because they're going to be the source for all these caterpillars that the birds need to feed their babies. And here we go. Here we go with the 6,000 to 10,000. There's the little nest of chickadees. And because they are such prolific foragers, we don't really have to worry about our caterpillars threatening our tree health. So here's where we can get the most benefit. So if you've got an area that, say, maybe your lot was completely cleared off, but your neighbor, some trees were preserved, and your other neighbor, some trees were preserved. So you could strategically place trees to bridge that gap to create a larger area of unbroken wooded area, and that's going to provide even more benefit than, say, just adding some trees up here. So that's one thing to think about. Google Earth is a great tool for looking, or Google Maps, and put it on the view that shows you this type of view is a great tool for kind of looking, getting that bird's eye view of your property and what's around it, and making decisions like, well, where can I get the most benefits from putting some trees in? Where am I going to unite maybe some existing areas? Or can I talk my neighbors into also planting some trees? Tree planting on a neighborhood scale can really add a lot of benefit. And of course, some people will say, oh, I'm not going to plant that oak tree. I won't ever live to see it be a big tree. So just tell yourself it's a shrub. And you'll be very happy. You're like, man, that shrub is really growing. So a young oak tree, yeah, it might be 30 or 40 or 50 years before it's this huge tree casting a lot of shade. But that doesn't mean it's not a wonderful thing to have in your landscape that you can't get a lot of joy out of. In fact, when trees are young, that's when you could really get close up and see things like birds nesting in it, where you can find those Polyphemus moth caterpillars. It's when they're still small and in range with your height. So don't worry about that you won't see it get big. Somebody will be able to enjoy it, and you'll get a lot of enjoyment from it too. So there's already a lot of our native trees. This is the eastern deciduous forest. We have a lot of trees that are used in landscaping. So some of the really common ones are things like river birch. You can find that pretty much anywhere that sells trees will have river birch. Red maple is another really common one. The thing we want to be aware of with red maple is don't put it in a parking lot. Don't put it somewhere where it's surrounded by pavement, even right out by the street. It really does need to be in an area where you have a lot of other natural area or non-paved surfaces, because when you get all that reflected heat from paved surfaces, it can really boost pest pressure. So there's a scale insect that can infect them, that populations really build up when you have extra heat. But it's a great tree for most yards, especially like in the backyard area. It's a beautiful tree. The blossoms on red maple, one of the earliest things to bloom, are really valuable for some of our pollinators. Black gum, of course, southern magnolia is another one that's really popular, big, large evergreen. So we have a lot of native trees that you can find. But by far, oaks are some of the most important trees to return to our landscapes, because they have value for so many different types of mammals and insects and birds. There's hundreds of species of oaks. They are excellent, very long-lived shade trees, typically are strong, structurally strong trees. Might take a little bit of strategic pruning when they're young to make sure they have the right shape. But you know, they provide all kinds of benefits. So these are really, if you're going to add a shade tree to your yard, I would really encourage you to add some type of oak. And of course, what we see is a lot of willow oak and a lot of pin oak, and they're good trees, but they're being used a lot. So they're fairly fast growing. In fact, among oaks are some of the fastest growing. The willow oak has the little narrow leaf like a willow. Pin oak has the more cut leaf. But let's get a little more diversity. There are other types of oak trees being grown by nurseries, so you should be able to find them. Some of the Piedmont native species that local nurseries are growing include the Schumard oak, the white oak, which is a little bit more on the slow growing side, but it's definitely, it's my favorite of my favorite oaks, but beautiful tree. Swamp white oak, the overcup oak, red oak, and scarlet oak. So these are trees that you should be able to find. If your local garden center doesn't carry it, if you could ask them, can you check with some wholesale nurseries? Because these are all being grown by wholesale nurseries in North Carolina. Or if you have a landscaper who's going to install a tree for you, they should be able to get one of these trees. And of course, there is always another option with oak trees, especially, is they make a whole bunch of acorns. And if the squirrels don't plant them for you, you can go and find them in the fall. You've got an oak tree you like, you know, go there in the fall and collect some of the acorns and plant them yourself. It's amazing how fast these young oaks, when they're young, they do grow quite quickly. And then they start to slow down, you know. But you can definitely grow your own oaks from acorns, and it's a very rewarding experience. Other things like persimmon is a great tree. A lot of garden centers may not necessarily carry it, but there are some nurseries out there growing it. Hickories are wonderful trees, but they're pretty difficult in nursery production. So the best way to get a hickory is to find some hickory nuts in the fall and bring them and plant them. Yeah, if somebody has a hickory tree, they'll usually share some with you. Things like American beech, some of these trees that aren't necessarily available as much in nurseries for landscapes, you might be able to get as seedlings through the Forest Service. So they're small, but they're very inexpensive. They're available in the fall and winter, and you get them as bare root seedlings, and you can plant them. So if you're having trouble finding something, that might be an option for finding some of these more unusual native trees. or less common, this less commercially available ones. So lots of options for trees. We'll look at some understory trees and shrubs. That's the layer that's really missing a lot of the time. You know, you might save some big shade trees and then you have just lawn. But if we can bring things back in, so we don't have a lot of that middle layer in here. We've got a few things, you know, but we could really see a lot more, a lot fuller, more denser, these areas, you know, up into this, up to 10, 15 feet high from the ground. So we want to see more of these plants. And of course, again, there's some really popular native trees, small trees, understory trees, flowering trees are all terms used to refer to these smaller trees. Things like redbud, extremely popular, very early blooming, the bees love it. Dogwood, of course. Everybody, most people, even if you're not a gardener, would at least know dogwood. Wonderful tree. Get it in the right place, though. You don't want to try to grow it out in really dry, exposed areas. American holly is another one that is used quite a bit in landscaping. So these are things you should be able to find fairly easily. Some things that maybe you don't find quite as often, but you can certainly, if you look for them at native plant nurseries or places that try to carry a little wider range, things like serviceberry, which is a native tree, one of the first of our fruiting trees to have ripe fruit. The fruit start to ripen in about this time of year and into June. And it is a nice, it's kind of got a similar habit, or can have a similar habit to redbud, often multi-stemmed, kind of spreading in the canopy. It'll grow in sun or part shade. It has white blossoms in the early spring before the leaves come out, and then the berries start to form. And they are quite tasty. They kind of, to me, taste like a cross between blueberry and cherry. They have a fairly big, some seeds in them, so some people don't like that. But you almost never get to eat them yourself because birds get them just as soon as they ripen. So these guys aren't ripe yet. When they're ripe, they turn much darker purple. And, you know, we had some, when I lived at, used to live down in Pender County near the coast, and there was this gang of mockingbirds that I think just, they were watched on them, and every minute one of these turned darker purple, swooped in and got it. You know, you could just hardly keep the birds from them if you wanted to have a few. Rust can get on these. There's a rust disease similar to the rust disease we see on apple trees. So that can be one issue, especially if you're trying to grow them for the fruit. But this is the plants in bloom. So you can see they have that multi-stem habit, and then they kind of spread out in the canopy. The blossoms are small, but there's lots of them. And they tend to bloom kind of just a little bit as the red buds are finishing. These guys are starting to bloom. These are the fruits when they're infected with this rust disease. So they look like something from outer space, you know. They get this little orange growth on them. Sometimes people will, you know, be interested in growing them for fruit production. And, you know, the rust disease can be a challenge and the birds can be a challenge for actual fruit production. But if you think about it as a landscape tree, it's a great plant.
Isn't there one that has thorns?
There are hawthorns that have thorns, but I don't know if any of the amelanchers that have thorns. So the hawthorns kind of have that similar habit and will make a fruit. So it may be a hawthorn that you're thinking of. Another native tree, kind of this medium height range, is fringe tree, Chinanthus virginicus. So these will often be, really will be like really large shrubs. They're multi-stem, they start branching and having foliage really low down unless you prune them up a little more. But this one is a favorite. This is one my grandmother had. She always wanted, my dad, you know, had to go out and dig one up from the side of the road, but I do not recommend doing that. So we want to leave native plants in their native situation, but you can buy this from garden centers. This one's just finished blooming, so it tends to bloom mid-spring as the leaves are coming out. There's these really fleecy flowers, and it is fragrant, so especially later in the evening, it has a drifting fragrance. And this is a tree, and one thing you'll find with a lot of trees and shrubs, particularly some of our native trees and shrubs, is there are male plants and female plants. So this is one of those plants that has separate male and female plants. So the male plants actually tend to have prettier blossoms, fuller blossoms, and just they put on a bigger flower show. But the female plants, they will definitely still bloom and be showy. This one's a male in the picture. But the female plants in the fall will have these beautiful berries, typically more like August. And they look like a lot like blueberries. They're not edible to people. But they're really pretty on the plant, and they don't actually last that long, though, because the birds love them. So if you have a female plant, you'll get the fruit. Male plants give you, both of them give you a good flower show, but the males particularly. The one thing about this plant, though, is late in the season, say August, September, it tends to defoliate kind of early. So it doesn't have nice fall color, and usually by September, and especially October, most of the foliage is gone. So you want to put it somewhere that you can really appreciate the spring show, but later in the year, maybe other things grow up around it and take the attention off of it. Sweet Bay Magnolia, this is a cousin to Southern Magnolia, the really big, dense evergreen one. Sweet Bay is kind of a smaller tree in all respects. It's not as tall. It grows a little bit differently too. Instead of being that pyramidal shape, it tends to have multiple stems and spread out a little more in the top, but it's still fairly narrow. It has a blossom just like Southern Magnolia, but it's smaller. It's fragrant. It does blooms this time of the year. And it is a tree in the wild you'll typically find in low wet areas. But it's fine in the landscape in just your average drainage. I wouldn't put it in the really dry, exposed spot. Then the blossoms in the fall are followed by these small cones that have these red berries, kind of very much a miniature version of what you see on Southern Magnolia. But those berries are extremely rich in lipids and proteins and a lot of, even squirrels and birds, great food source for them in the fall, getting ready to go into winter. And this is just the habit of a young tree. So as they get older, they tend to spread out just a little more at the top and lose some of these lower limbs. But this would be very typical what a young tree looks like. Some shrubs, things like Mount Airy Fothergilla. This is a wonderful native shrub that this one is a cultivar, so it's a selected variety. Some people suspect it's actually a hybrid between two native species, the Fothergilla major and Fothergilla gardenii. Other people say, no, it's just a slightly smaller version of Fothergilla major. But the really great thing about it is where normal Fothergilla major can get 10, 12 feet, this one only gets to be about 4 to 5 feet tall. The deer don't like to eat it. It does really well in sun to part shade. And these blossoms come out kind of early to mid-spring, just as the leaves are coming out. And they have a very distinct honey scent. They smell very much like honey. So the spring blossoms are quite pretty. It's kind of a cute plant when it's in bloom. But the real show is in the fall. This plant has amazing fall color, and it's very reliable. So even if we don't have such a great year for fall color, you'll still get, some nice yellows and oranges. We've got a really good year for fall color. You get these really intense reds and darker oranges and even crimsons. So this one is and it holds that color a long time. So starts to color up in October, but even by Thanksgiving sometimes you still have these leaves persisting. Inkberry is one of our few kind of small native evergreens. This is one that it can be a little more challenging. It's really common in the coastal plain, but we do find it. We're kind of on the cusp, the edge of its native range, but here in the eastern part of the Piedmont, you can still find it in the wild. Garden centers definitely will carry inkberry, particularly this variety Shamrock, which has been selected because it stays more compact. So it stays a little bit lower. One thing with inkberries is over time, they can tend to get a little bare at the bottom, so you might want to have something else growing in front of them so that you get the nice effect of the evergreen background, but something else can cover up that legginess. Inkberry is a type of holly, and hollies are one of these plants that have separate male and female plants. So Shamrock is a male variety, so you'll get the flowers. So both male and female plants will bloom, and you'll have the flowers. But only the female plants will have the little berries, the little dark berry, which gives the plant its common name of inkberry. One that we often grow for berries is American beautyberry. And again, this is one that the eastern Piedmont and eastern part of the state, you'll find this pretty common shrub. And so Calicarpa, which means beautiful fruit Calycarpa americana, our American beauty berry. There are some Asian species of beauty berry that actually the berries aren't quite as bright. They're a little bit more dull in color. And some of these Asian species have started to pop up, kind of coming up outside of the garden area. So there's a concern they could become a little too happy here and become invasive. But our American beauty berry has these super, super bright magenta fruit that start to color up in August, and birds love them. Goldfinches will come in, many types of birds will come in and feed on them. But this one it really looks best if you cut it back every year. So in the late winter, say March, if you go and cut this plant back so it's just about, 18 inches tall, cut everything off, and just leave kind of this foot to 2 foot stump. It'll grow out really strong. It blooms on new growth, so you'll get a lot of blooms, and then you'll get a lot of berries. You can, of course, you don't have to do that, but if you let it grow and after 3 or 4 years, it can kind of just get really large and a little bit bare in the middle. Here's some different pictures. So the bees like the flowers. The flowers are really tiny, but they're in little clusters on the stems. If you look closely, you can definitely see them. Birds love the berries, and this just happened to be a really neat caterpillar we found in our garden. It's the rustic sphinx moth. So it's related to the tomato hornworm, but it's not the same. It would not get on your tomatoes. But it was feeding on some of the foliage, and it looked really pretty. It had this little purple, this little lavender line on the side. So we go out into our landscape to take pictures of the caterpillars as much as the flowers or whatever else is there. We have some great native vines. I just picked this one to include the coral honeysuckle because it is a popular one. You can find it at garden centers, and it does have these beautiful tubular red blooms that hummingbirds love. And this really starts to bloom about the same time the hummingbirds are coming back. So it is a good food source to have in place for those hummingbirds as they come back in for the summer. Not only does it bloom in the spring, but it'll often throw out blooms in the fall. And sometimes you'll even have blooms, around Thanksgiving. It's not unusual to see some blooms on this plant. So you have that big spring bloom and then these sporadic shows throughout the summer and into the fall.
And it wants full sun.
It's going to give you the most blooms in full sun. If you put it somewhere shaded, because it is a vine, it's going to just grow to the sun. So it's just going to keep climbing until it gets to the sun. So it's definitely going to be a more manageable plant in full sun because it's not going to want to just go up to the, to the treetops. So if you have a trellis or an arbor in full sun, this is a wonderful plant to cover something like that. So we're going to finish up with some perennials. There's a lot of this is the most, diverse group of plants we have. We have lots of species of perennials native. And they're very important for nectar and pollen, for pollinators, for butterflies, for native bees, for honeybees. For many of the other insects we have pollinating our plants. So to really help those pollinators out, you want to have a lot of different types of perennials in your yard because you want to have things blooming from early spring to late fall. So you want to cover that whole growing season with blossoms because that's when the bees are going to be active. A lot of our native bees are active earlier in the spring than say maybe the honeybees. And then fall is also a really critical time for bees because they're trying to collect resources that'll keep them alive through the winter. So having that early, then all through the summer, and then late will give you the most benefit. And with pollinators, if you look at a lot of our native plants, they have this kind of architecture where they have little tiny blossoms, but lots of them together in a cluster. And that's really wonderful for pollinators because each one of these individual flowers has its own little pot of nectar, is making its own pollen. So you'll watch butterflies or bees on a plant like this, and they'll sit and they'll go here and they'll go here, and they'll spend a long time just on this one flower because there's all these resources there for them. Whereas this was something just like one big lily bloom. They just go, there's one pot of nectar, they collect that, but then they have to fly, and that takes energy to move to the next bloom. Then also when they're moving around like that, that increases the chance they might get eaten by something else. So this type of flower shape, this type of flower form is really valuable to pollinators. planting things in groups as well. So instead of just one of this, one of that, but having kind of a group of something, that makes it really efficient for pollinators to forage. They don't have to, you know, go here and then fly away over there. They can just work their way across this mass of blossoms. And also, you know, we like the way this looks. It gives you more of a block of color, and it's not quite so schizophrenic just to have tons and tons of different things, you know, all in one spot. So we want diversity. We want a lot of different species in our yard altogether, but that doesn't necessarily mean one. We can still have a sweep of this, a sweep of something else, you know, 3 to 5, you know, this is certainly a bigger planting, you know, 7 of something. So keep them together in those blocks. So I've got perennials here starting from early spring to late fall. So we're going to kind of start with some of our earlier blooming things. And green and gold is just, to me, a really valuable plant for most landscapes. Have places that green and gold could really, really help, you know. It's not one that you walk into the garden center usually and are totally blown away by it. I think it has the most cheerful little yellow blossoms, but they're about as big around as a quarter, just a real bright yellow, and the plants can have a lot of them. So it is very cute when it's in bloom, and it blooms a long time, March, April, May, they're still in bloom in my landscape. So you get a lot of bloom, but then even when it's not in bloom, they're evergreen. So, and it's low growing. And we need more low-growing evergreen things so we don't just have all this empty area in winter. And it likes shade. It actually prefers to be in part shade. So where it gets morning sun is wonderful. I've had them in sun all day, and you tend to find the blossoms bleach out a little bit. But part shade, this will be a very happy plant. It'll give you a lot of blooms in the spring. You'll find bees foraging on it. And then the rest of the season, you have a nice evergreen ground cover in place.
So it won't be just in a clump, it'll spread.
Yeah, so it depends. So if this is just the Chrysogonum virginiatum, our native form, it will stay in a clump and it'll self-seed. So you'll get little seedlings coming up. So it's a good one to naturalize in an area if you're trying to like fill in at the edge of the woods, give like a more little bit more formal appearance by creating an edge. It'll fill in over time. There is a different species, a subspecies, the variety Australis or Australi, that is staliniferous. So there is one that will spread, and it's like a strawberry plant. It produces stolons, and it does like that. So you do want to know which one you're getting. That'll tell you about the growth habit.
How can you tell which one you have?
So if you've got the staliniferous, the subspecies, it'll send out little shoots. Like a spider plant will or a strawberry plant, it'll send out these little shoots and they'll produce another little plant and it'll send out this little stem and it'll produce a little plant. So it's kind of spreading like that over the ground. That spreading one is also typically much lower. This one is about a foot tall. This one is the one we find growing wild around here in this area, native to this area.
The one that starts with a V.
Virginianum. Not by those stolons. It doesn't. It just spreads by seeds. So if you leave the blossoms and they make seeds, you'll get little seedlings coming up around your plant, which you can then leave to grow or move to somewhere else. Eastern columbine, another early bloomer, started in March this year for me. Then we had some really cold weather, and it kind of damaged some of the blossoms. Then it came back and had even more blossoms. So this one had 2 sets of blossoms for me this year, but Eastern columbine is the plant I often attribute to the fact that I'm a horticulture agent today, because my grandmother, going back to her garden, she always had these Eastern columbine, and I just thought they were so beautiful. I loved them, wanted to have some in my yard at my house, so she gave me some seeds. So I was probably about 10 years old, and she said just sprinkle them on the ground. And of course, so I did that and that didn't work. That was the first year. So next year I was still determined, I hadn't given up. And she gave me some more seeds. And I think that year maybe I tried to sow them in a pot and it still didn't work. I was 11 by then. So the next year I was 12 and I went to the library and got a book on growing plants from seeds and was able to learn that this is a plant that when you sow the seed, you need to give them a cold treatment. So you sow them. If you sow them when they ripen this time of year, you put them in some potting mix, you need to put them in the refrigerator for a little while to mimic the winter, and then they'll come up. So after 3 years, I was able to finally grow this plant. And that just really increased my interest in plant propagation and cultivating plants.
Well, in the yard.
In the yard, they will self-seed. So the place I tried to throw them when I was 10 years old was just a low wet area, and they didn't like that too much. So this is a wonderful plant. Even though I have a personal affinity for it, I think everybody does need some in their landscape because, again, very early blooms, really prolific. Pollinators love it, and then hummingbirds will also come and visit this, and you'll see them kind of come up and feed on the plant. It'll grow in part shade or sun. You can grow it out in the sun, but it's usually more, you find it more in part shade, and well-drained soil. So a lot of times in natural areas, you'll find it on slopes or even on rock outcrops, you'll find it growing. And that's where it will self-seed the best, in kind of more dry areas. And it will self-seed. So once the flowers are done, it makes these seed pods. They kind of face upwards. And if you don't want to let it self-seed, you need to deadhead it. You need to go cut those seed pods off before they turn brown and release all their seed. One plant can produce thousands of seeds. So it's a great one if you want to have seeds to share with people. You'll have plenty of seeds to share. Blue Star, Amsonia, this one's still blooming right now. This is one of our native perennials that's very long-lived. So this one can actually self-seed, but the individual plant itself is very long-lived. It makes a big clump, big root system, and it has these beautiful blue flowers, kind of pale blue flowers in the spring. Bees love them. Blue, yellow, and white and violet are the colors most attractive to bees. That doesn't mean they won't go to other plants, but you'll see a lot of honeybees and bumblebees on this plant. You'll see butterflies coming to visit it. It actually makes a really good cut flower if you like to cut things and bring them in. So it comes up, the blooms actually emerge on the stems, kind of enclosed as it comes up out of the ground. So when it blooms in the spring, it hasn't reached its full height typically. And this species, the Amsonia tabernae montana, is our native one. It gets to be about 2 feet tall, 2 feet wide, maybe a little bit bigger. And it will grow in very wet soil, so it'll tolerate really wet or poor drainage, or just your average garden area. I wouldn't put it somewhere like a real dry slope, but it's happy if it's just wet to average, sun to part shade, so pretty adaptable. So you have the blooms in spring. You can have some nice fall color. We don't usually think about perennials having fall color, but this one definitely can. Kind of a golden kind of color. And in the spring, and then in the winter, the stems are completely dead. You just cut all that off. There's nothing above ground that's alive. Okay. It does have I thought another picture was going to pop up. There is a relative of Blue Star called the Arkansas Blue Star that you find a lot. That's very similar, but it has very, very narrow leaves. And so Arkansas Blue Star, you can imagine, it's native to Arkansas, but it still does very well here, and it's very drought tolerant. So it actually grows in rocky exposed areas out in Arkansas. So if you had a really exposed site like that and you wanted something like Blue Star, I would look for the Arkansas Blue Star, even though it doesn't occur here in the Piedmont. Because it has a relative here, that means that many of the things that rely on it here locally can adapt to this Arkansas cousin.
We have one in the garden.
Yeah. Yeah, they're neat plants. And one thing I always do with all of the Amsonias, whether it's the Arkansas Blue Star or this species, is after they bloom, they make these long seed pods. And the seed pods get pretty heavy, and they kind of weigh the branches down, and the plant kind of gets a little bit floppy. And unless I specifically wanted to collect seed, I go and cut them back. So just below the point where the flower was, then the seed head will be there. I cut just below that. So I deadhead it after it's finished blooming, or I take the seed pods off before they ripen. And that keeps the plant a little tidier, and it'll push out a lot of new growth after that. And if you do leave all those seed pods, it's not unusual to find some seedlings coming up in your garden. So this is one that's pretty easy to grow from seed if you haven't collected some of your seed. The false indigos. There are several species native to the eastern part of the United States. The Baptisia australis is more one you find in the Midwest, but it is definitely happy growing here. This is probably the one that people have been more familiar with. Up until recently, we've started to cultivate more of our native types. But the blue false indigo, these are really tough plants. These are plants that stay in place. They're clump-forming plants. They will make seed pods. So if you leave the seed pods in place, you might get a few seedlings coming up. So you can certainly deadhead it or take those seed pods off to prevent that if you wanted to. So you'll find this one for sale. But some of our native ones that occur in North Carolina are things like the Baptisia alba, the white Baptisia. So very, very similar, but white blossoms. This is pretty typical for the growth habit. They come up out of the ground. They almost look like asparagus when they're coming up. These huge spears come up out of the ground, and they are just going for it. You know, they can have kind of this leggy area underneath, but then all this big cover of foliage. This plant would be at least 4 or 5 years old. It does take up the first couple of years. They're not going to be this big and full, but they have very extensive root systems. And once that gets established, they can make very impressive clumps. They're typically blooming in May, especially around Mother's Day. I often see them kind of peaking. And the older the clumps are, the longer bloom you'll get out of them. But the blossoms will come up above the foliage. These are some cultivars that bees love Baptisias, and they will go from one Baptisia to the next, different species of Baptisias, and so they'll often do the hybridizing for us. And if you leave some of your seedlings to come up in the garden, sometimes you might get some of these. Both of these varieties were found at the North Carolina Botanical Gardens, just naturally occurring hybrids from bees visiting some of the different species. And they're both really popular. Purple Smoke has these kind of lavender blue flowers, and it's a little bit smaller. So just your blue false indigo or the white one we just looked at, they can be fairly big, 3 foot, 3.5 foot. The Purple Smoke stays a little bit under, more between 2 and 3 foot. And then Carolina Moonlight is a paler yellow. Some of our native yellow ones are kind of a darker yellow. Has a similar growth form where, again, you can get these stems at the bottom, but that just gives you room to plant something else in front. Coreopsis. With a lot of our native plants, we have more than one species, and this is true for Coreopsis. We have some more spring-blooming types that tend to be shorter-lived self-seeders. The one I've chosen to talk about is specifically the thread-leaf Coreopsis, Coreopsis verticillata, as very narrow leaves. I like all the Coreopsis, but I really like this one because the foliage is great. It's very drought tolerant, and it's a more long-lived one. So it does tend to form like a mat, so each year it kind of spreads out a little bit, but not, clear across, the garden or somewhere. It's not going to come up far away from the parent plant. Just the plant itself gets a little bigger each year. So this one's definitely a great one for sun. Butterflies really like it. And it typically starts to bloom later May, June, or so an early summer bloomer. Same as with butterfly weed, and so these are really pretty together, that bright yellow with the bright orange. So this is the Asclepias we talked about earlier, the great one for supporting monarchs. So the butterfly weed, Asclepias tuberosa, very long-lived perennial, tends to stay in a clump, and has these bright orange flowers. Usually May, they're just starting to bloom right now, and you'll get some more blooms in June. If it gets mowed or eaten by caterpillars, it tends to come back up and bloom again. So you can even get 3 separate blooms from this plant. So this is the one you want if you've got a sunny site, if you have a drier site. It'll grow and bloom in part shade as well. And then hopefully you'll get the monarch caterpillars. This is a monarch chrysalis, which is quite unique, has these little gold dots. And you'll likely even get the monarch butterflies visiting the flowers for nectar. So we definitely want to include some Asclepias in our landscape. This one in the picture here is what's called common Asclepias, and it is very much an aggressive spreader. Most people wouldn't have room to put that in their landscape. If you had a big meadow or natural area, you might want to include it. But it's too spready, too vigorous for just a small home landscape. But this, either the orange butterfly weed or the swamp milkweed are great performers for landscapes because they stay in a clump. So the swamp milkweed, Asclepias incarnata, more of a summer bloomer, quite common as well. You'll find it in low wet areas, but in the garden it's fine in average drainage, or if you have a wet spot, it's a good one. So very similar, except it has these lovely pink blooms. It's a little bit taller than the orange milkweed, and it'll also grow in part shade. So wetter spots go with the swamp milkweed, drier spots, the orange milkweed. Another great one for pollinators, probably one of the, a plant that's gonna attract more different species of pollinators than most things you'll find just in the garden are the mountain mints or pycnanthemum. Even though they're called mountain mint, they definitely grow in the Piedmont, they grow all across the state. So there's over 12 species. They all of them tend to have little white flowers. And so they make a nice filler, they make a nice blender for other plants that maybe have brighter colored flowers. But they really are amazing plants just to watch, everything that's visiting them. So just sitting and watching the different pollinators that come to them. So this one's Pycnanthemum tenuifolium, which has a narrow leaf. It's quite a pretty one. There are some very showy ones that are quite spready. So there's two or three, at least three different species that have this more showy blossom where it actually has these kind of silvery colored bracts, which are just colorful leaves that surround the actual flower. So Pycnanthemum incanum, the hoary mountain mint, or I think Pycnanthemum virginianum is another one, that are very spready. So you see them on the roadside. They're really nice if you have an area you can let them spread. But if you want to have one that has that showy blossom but doesn't spread, there is this species, Pycnanthemum loomsii, which is a little bit harder to find. You'll have to start looking at some of the native plant nurseries, but it's got the really showy flowers and it stays in a clump, so it doesn't make those spreading roots.
On some of the slides, you're saying light shade, some of them saying dark shade.
Mm-hmm.
What's
the difference? So part shade mean typically, when I put part shade, I mean part of the day it's in sun. So it might get 3 or 4 hours of sun all in the morning, but in the afternoon it's in shade, you know, depending on what's creating the shade, a tree or a building. So you're getting 3 or 4 hours of direct sun, but then you're getting shade. So it could be morning or afternoon, but that's part shade. Light shade would be more dappled. So say you're at the edge or you're underneath pine trees or at the edge of where you have some trees. So typically you're not at any time getting full direct sun on the plants, but it's kind of bright. It's shaded. Like if you think about being under pine trees, it's shaded, but it's still kind of bright. It's not like being under an oak tree or in the shade of a building that's a much darker shade, a lot more of the light's being blocked out. So that's the difference. So, and typically anything that it says light shade would be perfectly happy with morning sun and then afternoon shade. So this is a close-up. And you can see the actual little blossoms are pink and in little clusters, and then they're surrounded by those silvery bracts. So very, very, this one, in addition to being pretty, it gets many, many different pollinators coming to see it. We see a similar flower structure here with Joe Pieweed. So lots of little blossoms all clustered together. This is one butterflies love. Joe Pieweed's typically blooming in August, September, and you tend to get a lot of swallowtails on it. So the larger butterflies, you can see dozens of them on one plant. It's really beautiful. We have a couple of species of Joe Pieweed. They used to be Eupatorium, and now the name's been changed to Eutrochium. But the Eupatorium fistulosum is the one that we find growing on the roadside or down in low wet areas here in the Piedmont. It's a great plant, but it can be quite tall, 5, 6, 7 feet. There is a species, the Eutrochium dubium, that's sometimes called the coastal Joe Pieweed, but it occurs right up to the edge of the Piedmont. It's naturally a little bit shorter. So it's the one that if you need something that's naturally just gonna stay 4 or 5 feet, that's a great species to look for. There's a variety named Little Joe, you may have seen. So Little Joe is actually this coastal plain species. So these are wonderful plants, whether you grow which species you grow. Cardinal flower, another one that you'll find in wet areas, beautiful bright red flowers again. So we're moving into late summer and fall. This is August and September. This is one that'll grow in sun or part shade. It likes wet to moist soil, so not one for really dry sites. And it makes these really striking spikes that get to be about 3 to 4 feet tall. that, as you can imagine, hummingbirds like, butterflies will love to see them. It makes it, the foliage is very low, it's evergreen, so you have to be really careful not to cover it with mulch in the winter. So make sure you leave those leaves exposed to sunlight. Then goldenrods, you know, I mentioned some of our goldenrods can be really vigorous, but others are good garden plants. And goldenrods are very similar to mountain mints, attract so many different types of pollinators. We'll get all the little skippers on them, which are kind of a type of butterfly that when they fly, they look like they're skipping. So these are blooming September, late August, September, October. This one, a variety, Solidago rugosa, there's a variety named Fireworks. That is very popular because it really, this is it in the picture, it looks like fireworks. The blossoms are just kind of spraying out. Really beautiful plant. And another one, so the fireworks is great for sun to part shade, but the wreath goldenrod will bloom very well even in shade. It's hard to find fall blooming plants that will bloom in shade, but this is definitely one that will. And you can see a bumblebee here stocking up for the winter on the wreath goldenrod. That's a very clumping plant. And then asters. Asters kind of round out the end of the season. We have several fall blooming asters, but I included this one, the blue wood aster, because again, it will bloom in shade or sun, and it can be really challenging for those shade, to find those shade tolerant plants for fall. And I did just include a couple of grasses, switchgrass. Grasses also add to the habitat value, and we have some things, particularly some of our skippers feed on grasses, but they're wonderful plants to add some contrast to perennials and winter structure, because even though they turn tan kind of colored in winter, they still have a nice presence. And there's several of these switchgrasses or panic grasses. This variety is named North Wind. It's one of my favorite. Very upright to about 4 or 5 feet. So think about adding grasses, especially for sunny areas. These are all going to be happiest in sunny areas. And I just want to close out just with a thought. This is from Doug Tallamy's first book, Bringing Nature Home, that a plant that has fed nothing has not done its job. So that really gets back to thinking a different way about plants we add to our landscape. Not only are we happy with their appearance, but we want it to help sustain other things that are living in our yard. So some resources, and these are all posted on the webpage. The Extension Gardener Handbook, if you've not checked that out, that is a wonderful resource, chapters on many different topics. But there is a chapter on native plants that you could go, that this PowerPoint supplements that chapter. The Going Native website, also an NC State Extension website, and it gives you lots of tips for how to use native plants in your landscape, and has a native plant database that you can look up and create your own plant list. You can save your search. Broader search of plants, the Extension Plants database, so you can search many different types of plants, including native, so it's going to give you non-natives as well. And when you look up a plant on the Extension Plants database, you get these great plant profiles. It includes pictures, it tells you how to grow it, it tells you how to propagate it. So lots of very important information. You can visit the North Carolina Botanical Gardens over in Chapel Hill. They have acres and acres of gardens of just native plants. And that is one of the best ways to learn about plants, is to see them growing in an actual landscape. There's also the North Carolina Native Plant Society that promotes native plants. You can visit their website, learn about their activities. If you're really interested in supporting pollinators, I encourage you to take a look at Debbie Roos's website. She's our sustainable ag agent in Chatham County, and she has a lot of information about planting for pollinators and several plant lists of great plants for bees and pollinators. The books that are listed here are all wonderful resources. The Native Plants of the Southeast is one of the more recent ones. If you're looking for a dictionary or an encyclopedia of native plants, I think this one covers about over 400 plants. The Bringing Nature Home and the Living Landscapes, if you want to learn more about using your plants in the landscape or that connection. Both of these are good books, a little bit older. But these slides, I think this list of books is actually listed on that webpage, which you can find. and it's on your handout. So I'd be happy to take any questions. And
are we going outside to see any native plants in the landscape around the building
then? We didn't plan to do that. But if there's some things, I haven't actually visited. This is the first time I've been to the Alamance Extension office. So if Mark knows some things to point out, we could do that. Or Chris knows, yeah. Yeah. In fact, as I was driving, I was almost drove by the place, and the thing that said, that's it, is the garden. So I was like, that's it. I'm going to pull in here.
We have several of the described species in the garden.
Great. You know, and this really is just a small set. We could have been here all day. I know you don't want to sit here all day, but there's dozens and dozens of other plants we could have talked about. And some of the things I have posted on the website include more plant options for you. Yeah.
I live on property that has not been used before, so I have a lot of, I guess, native plants on it.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things that's driving me crazy is the dewberries. Are they considered native, or is that an invasive native that was brought in and now?
Like a blackberry relative, the dewberry, like, are you talking about like a low thorny plant that spreads like blackberry,
yeah.
Dewberry?
Yeah.
I believe that one is native. We have several native rubus, which are the blackberry family. So, but if it's a nuisance to you, because you don't want to walk on that, I've walked on it. It's not fun.
Berries,
Yeah, I mean, you know, so if it's the wrong plant in the place, then mowing it usually gets rid of it. It doesn't persist after mowing. In my yard, it didn't. But, you know, so you could definitely bring a sample in. So it's always good to know absolutely for sure what you're dealing with. So bringing a sample to your local extension office for a positive ID, and then trying to figure out and make decisions about what to do.
Yeah, I have an aggressive button plant. It's a little
button plant.
Yeah, Don't know that.
Well, so there's a couple. There's Barbara's buttons, which is a native that's blooming right now,
just
like a pale pink.
And
so you might have what's called button weed.
Yeah, button weed.
That one's, I don't know if that one's native or not, but yeah, that one is often a weed, especially somewhere where drainage is poor.
Yeah, and it's hard to get, I mean, I've got it in my garden.
Yeah.
If you cut the roots, it just, I mean, if you try to plow it up, it
yeah,
just...
Yeah, every piece of root regenerates.
So
yeah.
Any suggestion how to get rid of it?
Yeah, a lot of persistence in trying to get as much of the root system out as possible. But, you know, the definition of a weed is a plant out of place. So any plant can be a weed if it's interfering with, say, trying to grow vegetables, or it's a thorny plant and you want to walk or play in the area. So... weed management always starts, though, definitely with knowing exactly what you have, getting it identified, and figuring out the options. But button weed's a challenging one because all the root pieces left behind sprout. Yes?
I've got a normal spot that's, let's say, 100-foot trees that grow up so high that I only get sun from 11 till 2.
Uh-huh.
So I can't grow a garden anymore.
Right.
But it's got some grass and weeds. How can I get, what should I do to prepare it to all of a sudden now put some of these shade-loving
plants in? Well, so if you're going to take an area that is lawn or, like you say, just kind of a mixture of whatever's growing and convert it to turn it into a planting, a landscape bed, first you need to try to get rid of what's there. So depending on what's there, sometimes just mulching it really thickly and keeping it mulched really thickly for several months can work. But if you have anything perennial plants growing there, or things like Bermuda grass, the mulch isn't going to get rid of them. So, you know, you might need to spray with a herbicide. That's definitely going to be the quickest way to get rid of that existing vegetation. Sometimes if it's a sod area, you know, a turf area, you could get a sod cutter and actually take the turf up. So there's several options, but I definitely, again, I would start with figuring out what's there right now, and is it something that I can get rid of, you know, just by smothering it, or is it something I actually need to dig up or spray with a herbicide, you know, so because you don't want it to be a problem for when you put your other plants in. So once you can get rid of the existing vegetation, some things... you might even be able to just till into the soil. But that's very much going to depend on what it is. So you want to add some organic matter, some compost to the soil, cultivate it. And then you should be ready to plant. Soil test, always a good idea to figure out, you know, what your existing pH is and nutrients. But fall is a great time to plant, even for many plants. So fall is a great time. So if you started getting the bed ready and figuring out right now what's there and how to get rid of the weeds or the grass that's there, you should definitely be ready to plant. You could be ready to plant by fall. All right, so I'd be happy to answer any more questions if you have them individually, but I know you're probably ready to head out and go to lunch. I appreciate the opportunity to talk to you today. Thank you.
We have gardening classes, usually about two per month. So I think Green Thursday's class schedule, all different kinds of gardening topics. So we've done pruning. We'll have a class on vegetable gardening. We'll have a class on birds. We have a rain garden class, drought-tolerant plants, fall lawn care. It's quite a long list of gardening classes we provide to the public to give them a better understanding of different gardening topics. All our classes are free, and they're held at 10 o'clock on Thursday morning here in the Ag Building.